my first time in Quebec, first time in Montreal. It's a real beautiful city, and I thank you for the opportunity to be here. And I've been walking around a bit. And speaking of walking around, I fell off of a ladder. Those of you that are older than 50, ladders are the biggest cause of injuries in men our age, at least. And now, increasingly among women, I have hip replaced, so I may choose to sit on the corner of this table at times during my talk. I hope you will forgive me. What I'm going to do today is to tell you, and I'm going to take my jacket off, if you don't mind. My mother always told me, and make sure you wear a jacket so that people know you have one. I have one. Informality is much more my style anyway. Let me tell you my story. My story is about a term that Bentley and Hitch call working memory, although they weren't the first ones. The term working memory had been around for a while, actually, before Bentley and Hitch used it. And I was interested primarily in limitations. You know, we're all faced with limitations if you're in a strange city and you're trying to find your way around and trying to read a map and find the orientation, and it's in a language that you don't understand very well. And I spend a bit of time in New Zealand, and there the language I understand fine, but you know, I'll go across the street and all of a sudden there's a car coming from a direction I hadn't expected it. So, you know, those limitations are around us all of the time. We find ways around those. You know, we're human beings are quite good at circumventing those, but nevertheless, the thing that has always interested me is how those limitations come into play in real world activities. So that really is my story. Early on, I treated this as a trait variable. How many psychologists are in the room? Any psychologists? Well, there's a construct called anxiety, and we think of trait anxiety. You know, it is clear that, you know, when we come into the world as infants, that we have a genetic predisposition to either high anxiety or low anxiety, somewhere on that continuum. It's not a dichotomy. But in addition, things make us more or less anxious. So we can think of anxiety as both a trait variable and as a state variable. And over the last 5 years, I've come to the conclusion that working memory capacity is exactly that way, that it is both a trait variable and a state variable. Let me say, first of all, that this thing down here at the bottom is real. Every paper I've ever published is available for download at that website in PDF format, in great violation of corporate American Psychological Association rules. I expect to be sued any day.
No, it's not.
Pardon?
No, it's not.
No, it's not.
APA says go ahead and do it.
Yeah, well, that's good. And I'm the new editor for APS. And it's okay with them. So I've done this for a long time, and you know, I think it's something we as scholars ought to do. But my reading of the fair use says it's okay anyway. And the tasks that I use, many of the tasks that I use are available there as well. They're in E-Prime, which many people use. But anyway, it's there if you're interested. If you're not, don't go there. So let me give you an outline of my talk. First of all, I want to get to really the question that I've been dealing with over these many years, and I've been working on this problem since 1980. It's a long time. And the question has changed a lot over that time. And so, for example, one of the things that I deal with now is fluid intelligence, and just intelligence broadly speaking. And I was trained as an experimental psychologist, an anal retentive experimental psychologist at Ohio State, the Dust Bowl of empiricism. It never occurred to me when I was taking regression classes as a graduate student that I would actually have to use those techniques. So the question has changed over the years, and you'll see. And now I'm studying brain science. I just had a brand new fMRI machine in the psychology department. We have no med school at Georgia Tech, but I was chair of the department for 13 years, and the last thing I did was to get this humongous scanner and the facility for it, and I'm the director of the center for it to get started. So I'm doing brain stuff. I'm also doing genetic stuff, and I never would have thought even 5 years ago that I would be pulled into studying genetics and so forth. I will tell you a little bit about my approach, which is a little strange because it combines the two broad schools of approaches of psychology. And I'll deal more with that in a moment. I'm going to get your way. So if you feel like you want to move, it'd be easier for you to move than for me, I expect, but that's fine. So I'll tell you about my approach. I then will tell you a little bit about working memory and sort of my overall take on working memory after doing this work for almost 30 years. And working memory as a system, not just, you know, people think of working memory as 7 plus or minus 2 or some number. And that's not what I'm interested in. That's not the topic. That's not where I find the most interesting action in the study of working memory. And we'll talk about that a little bit. I'll then deal with what we call complex span tasks that work. Now, work for me means that I can study something in the laboratory. I can take a complex phenomenon out in the real world. I can bring it into the lab, which is what good scientists do. You know, chemists don't do their work in a toxic waste dump. They bring it into the lab where they can control things. So why is it that complex span tasks tell me something important when simple digit span, simple letter span, you know, tasks that have been around for well over 100 years don't tell you very much? That's important, in my opinion. We'll talk a little bit about some psychometric aspects of that. Probably not. I'll cut so much of that as I if I spend more time on this preamble. I've got a whole lot of math here. I'll then talk about evidence that this construct that I study, working memory capacity, really reflects individual differences. It says cognitive control, but it's not just cognitive control. It's more and more clear that emotional control as well, my ability to control my temper, my ability to control my passion, my ability to control my emotions, positive and negative, is very much related to this construct. My ability to control my behavior, that it's hard to define as cognitive because it's so molecular, so simple. It's control, control of the system, control of attention. That if I'm standing here talking to you and somebody walks in, you know, 15 million years of evolution have prepared me to look for that, because things that move can either eat us or we can eat it. Both are extremely important to survival in this part of the world we live in. And yet my ability to prevent that, to keep things from intruding, capturing your attention, that's a very primitive concept. And that's what we're talking about. So we're talking about something that's exceedingly general, in my opinion. And that's, you know, this idea of cognitive control, and I'll give you a take-home message. First of all, let me tell you something. Who in here is over the age of 50? I have bad news. Who's over the age of 22? I have bad news. Who's under the age of 22? I have bad news. if we look at, this is a set of data. There are a lot of people in my department that study the effects of aging on cognition. I don't do that, but it's highly relevant to what I do study. And so if we look at these are taken from the verbal scale and the performance scale of the WACE, and it's a scores, IQ adjusted scores, as a function of age in years. And we can change that to crystallized intelligence. I'm a real believer in the morning to tell model of intelligence, which is there's a crystallized intelligence and then there is a fluid intelligence. Crystallized intelligence is basically what we know. It's what you've learned over the years. And fluid intelligence is your ability to do novel things, to solve novel problems, to deal with novel situations, reason. And there's a great deal of evidence that this construct is heavily dependent on this construct. Okay? Clearly, we're talking about nature and nurture here. But nurture is, you know, you can only, if you're high in fluid and I'm low in fluid, you're going to be able to acquire information from your environment more rapidly than I can. Richard Flynn of the Flynn Effect has had some really wonderful recent work suggesting that, in fact, if you're high in fluid intelligence, you will seek environments where you will learn more. So these things are interrelated. But look at how it changes over time, over age. And what we see is that crystallized intelligence remains relatively even, and particularly from a verbal standpoint, that, you know, up to 50, verbal intelligence actually goes up and stays high until right at the end. And actually, if we lined this up at death, and we lined it up and looked at the last 6 months, and we took that out of the picture because you've got something called terminal drop, which is that you show huge declines in the last 6 months of your life for cognitive decline. So if your father, both my parents have died in the last 10 years, and I noticed it exceedingly clearly with both of them. If we take that out, then in fact, this line pretty much stays flat across. Look at fluid intelligence, however. See that little peak right there? That's at 22. 22, and it's downhill from there. I'm sorry. So this idea of fluid intelligence is really important, and it's important to understand what that is. Now, when I set out on this trip of trying to understand working memory, it never occurred to me that I would be looking at things like this, but it's clear that we are. So let's look at, these are studies from a former student of mine named David McCabe at Colorado State. And if we look at this actual measures of fluid intelligence looked at by the brainless progressive matrices, and I'm generally going to use the construct term, probably not talk a lot about the tests if you have questions about them, I can. These are all heavily loaded GF measures. And what we see is the very same thing. We see this very straight decline over age. These are grouped ages from 18 to 90. If we look at digit span, now digit span's been around since 1867, published in Nature by Jacobs in 1867, used by Galton in his studies at the World Exposition in London. You know, it's been around a long time, and it's a part of virtually every standardized test. How many digits can you remember in correct order? Well, you know, it's not totally flat, but if you took out, again, that terminal drop, it looks quite flat. It looks like crystallized intelligence, doesn't it? And I would submit that in most cases it is. It doesn't tell you very much. Now, I haven't told you what complex span tasks are, but I will in a moment. If we look at them, what we see is a very different pattern. We see that they mimic fluid intelligence. So what we're looking at here is memory for a set of letters or a set of digits, but it's whether it's embedded in a complex task or just a set of letters or digits remembered by themselves. So this is a really, I think, an important phenomenon. It says that with these complex span tasks, we are indeed looking at something that is fundamentally important to development, and I would submit to individual differences at a given age. Most of the studies that I do are with people 18 to 35, so they're with you, right? And there are individual differences in that, and you'll find those, you know, those individual differences at every one of these age groups. So here are my initial questions. That is, what do these complex memory span tasks measure? What is the construct that makes these things important? What is it that they measure? Now, I'm going to talk a little bit in a minute about the psychometric approach and the experimental approach. And most psychometricians really don't think very much about what's the nature of what they're measuring. They just want to have tests that predict things. Well, that's an important part of psychometrics, but I'm an experimental psychologist, so I'm interested in understanding what those tests measure. And I want to understand why these complex span tests do such a good job of predicting performance in a huge range of higher level tasks out in the real world, what we can call feral cognition, you know, walking around cognition, wild cognition, while simple span tasks do so poorly. Let me give you some summaries, and if you get nothing else out of this talk, you take this next slide, you can then go home, and you'll have probably most of what you're going to get out of this talk today. Except pick up a donut on your way out, whatever this handout, you can get that too. First of all, most people, when they think of short-term memory, working memory, think of George Miller's 7 plus or minus 2. More recently, my friend Nelson Cowan has proposed that this limitation is really 4 plus or minus 2. Great deal of evidence that smaller limitation is, in fact, closer to correct, and it may be just one. It may be that, in fact, you can only think about one thing at a time, but if you think about thing one, if you have Dr. Seuss fans in here, you got thing one, and then you suddenly shift your attention to thing two, that the memory for thing one fades or is interfered with, is lost relatively quickly. So you're really thinking about one thing at a time, but you've got these activations of thing one. But that's not what this is about. You know, that's not That's not the nature of the construct that I'm measuring. I'm convinced. I'm convinced of that. Nelson Cowan and I are very good friends. When I assumed the editorship of Current Direction of Psychological Science in January, he was the first person I asked to write a paper, but we disagree about almost everything. And we spent 2 weeks in a car in New Zealand. It was great because we just argued all. I think the problem, the real core of this construct, is in the interface between attention and retrieval from inactive memory. So if you shift from thing one, thinking about thing one, to thinking about thing two, and all of a sudden now you have to bring back something about thing one. It was just recently active, but whoop, that was 10 seconds ago or 2 seconds ago. You now have to get that information back. That's where the problem occurs. Now, is that an attention problem? Yes. Is it a memory problem? Yes. So it's at that interface between memory and attention that's really the crux of this issue. I'm convinced of that. And, my former student, Nye Shuttleworth, and I had a paper in psychological science last year that makes that point. Thirdly, for somebody who has studied working memory and individual differences in working memory capacity for so long, I would think that virtually everything in the world depends on that. And I think that's not true. That, in fact, much of what we need to know to function, even in a very complex modern world, we have learned, and we can just retrieve relatively automatic retrieval from long-term memory, and we do just fine. You know, you can drop me in any big city in the world, and, you know, if it's laid out in a relatively straightforward fashion, if I can read the street signs, you know, I can probably get along. And you know, I mean, there are enough commonalities in those situations that I'll be able to do okay. And that's really true for much of the world that we live in. That is, we have, certainly by my age, I've learned enough to survive in lots of different situations through this automatic retrieval. And it's abundantly clear that while search might be effortful and slow and controlled, that retrieval is relatively automatic. You know, when I see a face of my colleague, I don't have to think about his or her name. Boom, it just comes to mind. When I see an airplane or enter an airplane, a script for behaving, just boom, it just happens. It just is retrieved without any real need for this notion of working memory. However, the problem occurs when the situation gives rise to a retrieval that's inappropriate to this task. It was appropriate to a previous task, but today it's wrong. If I retrieve that, it's wrong. If I'm in a situation where I walk up to a street corner and I look to my left, then it's bad. Okay? In this situation. Driving, I spent a lot of time in England and in New Zealand, and driving in both of those countries, I don't have any difficulty because the cues are very powerful, telling me what to do. I get in a car in New Zealand, the steering wheel is on a different side from what I'm used to. Okay, that's a very powerful cue. Cars are coming from the other direction, telling me where I need to have my car. You know, the signs are very clear. If I'm on the wrong side, I'm looking at the back side of the signs. There are lots of cues telling me what to do. Where I have real problems is crossing the street, repeatedly. You know, so I spent a chunk of time with Alan Badley's group when he was at Cambridge at the Applied Psych Unit, particularly in a relatively small town in England where lots of people ride bicycles. So you don't have the car noise to guide you. So inevitably, I would walk up to a street corner, either with a tour guide or something in my hand, or talking with somebody that is under load. And I define load very broadly. It's, you know, thinking about anything. Okay, it's not having to do another task, it's just thinking about anything. I mean, I walk up to a street corner, and, you know, I look to my left, and I take a step, and some little old lady on a bicycle is going to run right into me. It's happened repeatedly. So what happens is, you know, in London, you know, they've started helping me out. They don't say, look to your right, you stupid Americans, but that's what they mean. Right? That's really what they mean. I'm surprised there aren't body outlines on the pavement there for people who've been run down. You know, now why is that? I mean, you know, if you say, in England. Which way do you look when you cross the street? I should look to my right. I know that, but what immediately is retrieved and comes to mind is this, what has been taught to me, conditioned to me, Pavlovian-like, since I was a child. You walked up to the street corner, you looked to your left. So I think in lots of situations like that, where we're in a novel situation, you know, this idea of attention control becomes very important. Now, I don't think that I have to, I'm convinced that I don't have to keep in this active focus of attention, look to your right, all of the time when I'm walking in the city. That's ridiculous. But what I have to be able to do is to somehow dampen down this idea of always look to your left, suppress it, if you will, and or make it rapidly available that when I go up to a street corner, I have to have rapidly retrieved, look to your right, look to your right, look to your right. I think that's a very, very common set of procedures in the situations that I'm talking about. Now, let me just give you a glib overview of working memory. I think it's a system of temporary stores. Badley and Hitch argued for a language-based phonological store and a visual spatial thing we call a sketch pad. I think there are dozens of these formats. I think that these are just formats for temporarily coding information. I think I can store temporarily smells, sights, tastes, just dozens of things. Even in so-called the phonological loop, they're really talking about an articulatory, a motor representation, if you will. But I can code the sound, I can take Guillaume's voice, and I can generate a set of speech that I've never heard him say, but I know enough about his voice that I can generate that code in his voice. Right? That's not really phonological because I have to rely on these acoustic features. So I think there are dozens of these. And you know, the way science is, you start simple and you make it more complex. But I think it is these temporary stores. But and this limited capacity attention, what later on I'll call executive attention. I think the function of this system is either maintaining information as active, that is keeping it highly active, and there are times we just really have to do that all the time, okay? And or making it easily retrievable. And I think most of the situations I'm talking about, it's that part that's making information that used to be active very, very recently, but is now no longer in active focus of attention, making it so that it can get back to active focus very quickly. I think it's particularly important for dealing with the effects of interference and distraction. I've made an argument that if you didn't have proactive interference, if you didn't have distraction in our environment, there would be no need for the system. Maybe you're wrong, and but it's a nice place to generate some interesting studies. The differences that I talk about, I think, are due to this executive attention. That is the ability to control where your attention is allocated. This gets this idea of homunculus or organized behavior. We were talking about birds and a pattern coordinating, their behavior appears to be coordinated. When there is no homunculus, there's no central executive, same way with termites building a mound and so forth. It's an interesting question as to whether we need to have something that controls us. You know, I am a materialist, not a spiritualist. It is done by nerve cells, and somewhere along the line we'll understand this. Let me just say for the philosophers in the room, that you know, I'm perfectly willing to treat this homuncular like for right now as a place mark. You know, I know full well that there is no little person in my head making this decision, but I'm perfectly willing right at this point to treat it as a place mark. Eventually we're gonna, and I think there are people I know and respect, like John Cohen, Don Draper, and so forth, that are actually working on computational models for this system that give me hope. I've already said that this construct is important to regulate thought, emotion, and behavior. All right, let's talk about some tasks, some concrete things here. A simple span task, I'll present you with a letter at a time. I'll present you with five letters, B, N, K, J, S. I just show them to you, and you have to recall them back in the correct order. That's when I talk about a simple span, that's about as simple as it gets. We could use digits, but digits are a horrible thing to use in the modern era. Because if you've ever stopped to think about how many pins, addresses, phone numbers you have, it's enormous. And trying to do experiments with those without that becoming a huge variable, That is, everybody's got a different pattern. But you look at a string of numbers, and you'll see just random numbers, so you'll do badly. I see one address there, okay? So I'm going to do well. It has nothing to do with anything important to me, except that I used to live at that place. So I don't like to use that. You could make an argument here, but I don't want to spend time with that. In 1980, Meredith Danlin, who was a Robbie Kay student in Ontario, went to Carnegie Mellon and did a set of studies. I'm going to get a dig at Meredith here. She worked with Robbie Kay. How many of you know Kay's or know Kay's work? I mean, he's dead now, but really, really bright guy. He worked with Juan Pascual Leone and made this argument, and she developed this task and did cite him in this paper, which I find inexcusable. And what she did was she had people read a sentence and then remember the last word. I don't like that procedure. I won't take the time to tell you why. Here's the way we do the reading span. There's a sentence. People read the sentence aloud, and there's a letter, just like here. This, by the way, allows us to control and to compare tasks. So here, the tiger left to the ridge, B, I'll never forget my days in combat, him. And then at some point, they have to remember these letters in correct order, just like over here. But then they have to answer a question about one of the sentences. So some level of comprehension is necessary. Is that clear? And what you find, what Danlin and Carpenter found, was that the number of letters, or number of words actually remembered here, predicted performance in comprehension exceedingly highly compared to a simple span. My student Miriam Turner and I, in 1983, developed a task called the operation span. It's very different, involves math. It is 3 times 1 minus 1 equals 3. First has to say yes or no. Is that correct? Then they get a B. And then at some point, they're going to get a query. They don't know how many of these they're going to get. Then at some point, they get some question marks and have to call the letters in correct order. But when we did the first study in 1983, as an aside, I'll tell you that I thought we'd do this study, showed that it was all about reading, predicting reading. Totally uninteresting. It's like saying dead people can't read. Not interesting that when you do math, doesn't, you know, well, I was wrong. And typically, for my career, my biggest advances come when I'm wrong. And this, the number of letters remembered here, or words in our 86 and 89 papers, predicted performance of reading comprehension just as well as the reading span did. So it didn't matter that you changed to math, or virtually anything else, it turns out. So these are verbal tasks, and these two are complex tasks. So when I talk about complex tasks, I'm typically talking about a task where you get something to do, then you get something to remember, then you have to shift your attention back to doing something else, reading another sentence or doing another math problem, then you get something else to remember. So what you have to do is to retrieve the emerging list of things that you have to remember and add something to it. Is that clear? These work, this doesn't work. That's a very glib overgeneralization. We've also got a lot of different tasks. So these are spatial working memory tasks. And so here the subject has to rotate this, and when you rotate it, is it a good G or a inverted G? They then get an arrow going in one of 9 directions and one of 3 different lengths, and then they get another letter rotated. Is it a good F or bad F? They get another arrow. At some point, they'll get a set of boxes, and they have to draw in the length and direction of the arrows they saw. So there's no real verbal content here. It's just the rotating letters, but they don't have to remember the letters. In this task called the symmetry span, they have to make a decision, is that symmetrical? If I were to pause it, I could draw a straight line down through that. Is that symmetrical around the vertical axis? Yes or no? And the answer there is no. See a cell filled in a grid that goes away. Yes, it's symmetrical. See another cell. At some point, you have to fill in the matrices. Is that clear? So these are spatial tasks here. It's a task that you have to say whether each corner is an outside corner or an inside corner like that one. They then see a blue ball that goes across the screen in any number of different directions. At some point, they have to replicate the direction of that. So we've got these very spatial tasks and verbal tasks. Do those things measure the same thing? And the answer is yes, they do. They load, I won't go into what structural equation modeling does, but if we do structural equation modeling here, we see that these tasks load on a single factor very, very well. The verbal tasks up here and the spatial tasks here loaded on a single factor, that just says it's a good loading. And if we force two things, so we've got a verbal working memory and a spatial one, we can do that, and it sort of fits, but the correlation is 0.93. So, you know, I'm willing to conclude on the basis of this that we really aren't dealing with a single construct here that's both verbal and spatial. That's important from a psychometrics standpoint. And if we collapse across all of these different tasks and look at these complex fan tasks, broadly speaking, look at where they've been shown to, quote, work, we see that they predict performance in a lot of higher order tasks. So, for example, reading, listening, comprehension, which goes from Dannemann and Cochran in 1980, 1983, dozens and dozens of other studies, that the number of letters recalled in that reading span or the number recalled in that reading and the operation span predict very well the following task. I'm going to give you a paragraph. I'll read it. I'll say it to you rather than have you read it. Bill and Fred went to the grocery store. Bill bought some ice cream and carton cigarettes. Fred bought some toilet paper and cheese. They were on their way home to put the food away, and all of a sudden there was an accident. No one was hurt, but they were delayed. They finally got their crippled car home, and when they did, he quickly put the ice cream in the freezer. Who's he? It's called phenomenal reference. Phenomenal reference means you've got to go back and retrieve who bought the ice cream. Okay, very simple thing, and we use pronouns all the time for very good reason. Well, it turns out that the working memory capacity predicts performance on that, answering that question, who's he, who bought the ice cream, at about a 0.9 level, according to Dan Carpenter. It's a little high, but it's you know, it is quite high, even when done right. We can show that, talked about following directions, I have a paper with first graders, third graders, and college students looking at either oral directions or map directions, and working memory capacity predicts very, very well how well kids do directions like, okay, children, take out your book and take the red pencils and mark the answers to the problems number 3, 7, and 5 on the yellow answer sheet. Well, that's a working memory problem, and you know, and interestingly enough, you see things like that. That's a little bit extreme, probably, but you see things like that in elementary school settings all the time. My wife is a school psychologist, and it's just amazing that, you know, the situations where, in fact, teachers put children in a working memory load, and good teachers know, learn very quickly how to adjust. We're talking about adjusting to the situation before. Good teachers learn how to adjust their instructions to the capacities of their children. I've never done a study on that, but there's a dissertation there somewhere. So following directions, vocabulary learning, Meredith Downing did a wonderful paper in 1986 showing that working memory capacity predicted your ability to learn vocabulary from the environment. Just, you know, most of the words we know, we didn't learn by reading it on dictionaries, word of the day kind of thing, or something like that. We learned by hearing a word in a context and picking up, you know, what that meaning is from the context. And working memory capacity predicts that very well. Supervised a dissertation on note-taking, shows a strong relationship between working memory capacity and the quality of notes, the extensiveness of notes, and what a college student is able to do from those notes. Writing, a guy named Ron Kellogg, Deborah McCutch, and others have done a lot of work on working memory and writing. Complex reasoning, a strong relationship between reasoning ability and working memory capacity. Complex learning, and I'll very quickly tell you one study there. Pat Tillman, who's now an educational testing service, had a lab with the Air Force where he brought people into this setting. He had a bank of, I don't know, like 50 computers, and he would just bring people in, either Air Force recruits or people he hired for this. And in one of his studies, he hired temporary workers to come in for a week of learning to write computer programs. And the question is, what predicts who learns the best after a week of computer-aided instruction in how to program a computer in C++? And they gave them this huge battery of tests, and if you ask your grandmother what kind of things would predict who can best write a program, you might say, well, experience with computers, or knowledge of algebra, or knowledge of science would predict better than, oh, I don't know, working memory capacity, maybe these dippy little tasks that Eagle's been developing in Georgia. The answer is no. that working memory capacity accounted for almost all of the bearings. And all these other things, these complex things that my grandmother would have thought would be important, added no incremental validity. Okay? And that's very important that, you know, here we're dealing with these dippy little tasks predicting how well people can learn to write computer programs in a very real-world setting. Chris Ruin, clinical psychologist in England, has shown that this idea of intrusive thought, now, it was done in the context of Wagner's, Gilbert's Don't Think About White Bears situation, but it's clear that, you know, when this white bear task, and I don't have time to go into that if you don't know what the white bear task is, basically tell people, don't think about white bears, but if you do, ring this bell. So we can sort of get an introspective assessment of intrusive thought. And working memory capacity predicts the ability to prevent intrusive thought very well. And that's hugely important because intrusive thought is now sort of one of the cornerstones of psychopathology studies, at least in America, but in other places as well. It also turns out that working memory capacity corresponds to performance at lower order tasks as well. If we look at an association between controlled attention and automatic processing, and this is Larry Jacoby's work, we see it real clear that finding that working memory capacity is important for the control stuff, but not the automatic. Vulnerability to proactive interference. When I first moved to Atlanta, I go to a mall and I park my car. Very first time, I don't think about where I park my car, but I come out and I find it without any difficulty. After going to that mall about 10 times, if I don't think that, okay, I'm parked under this light, it's blinking a little bit, if I don't do something like that, I come out and I've got this huge problem with proactive interference because of all these previous times I've parked there. Turns out that low working memory individuals are much more vulnerable to that than our high working memory individuals. That's a very pervasive problem. Dichotic listening, there's an old finding, Neville Murray in England had people listening to two different messages spoken, different messages, one in each ear, and they were to shadow back the words in one ear and to ignore the other, but at some point the person's name was spoken in the ignored ear. Now, if you read any introductory type book that I've ever used, they say people hear their name in the ignored ear. Yeah, at the end of the experiment, you say, did you hear anything weird? They say, yeah, they said my name over there. Well, turns out if you actually read Murray's paper, only 30% of people heard their name, reported hearing their name. Now, as somebody who studies individual differences, I go, aha, variation. All right? And so my student Andy Conway and Nelson Callum, and one of Andy's students named Mike Bunting, actually did a study based on this, because I predicted, I always said this in class, that I think if you did this psychotic listening, you'd find the difference between high and low span subjects. And it turns out that only about 20% of high spans hear their name, but 65% of low spans hear their name. Now, once they hear their name, they immediately start tracking the other channel. And if you tell high spans, now, pay attention, there's going to be something important in that ignored ear, all of a sudden they're going to do well. But high spans are actually better at blocking distraction than our low spans. We see the same thing in the Struth task, particularly where there are congruent trials. Everybody knows a Struth where you have to name the color of the ink, and here it's red, here it's green, although I really want to say blue. Well, if you've got congruent trials in there, but I look at the performance on the incongruent trials, we see that low spans make many, many more errors than do high spans. So it's this ability to control, to prevent your attention being captured. Object-based visual attention, I won't go into that, but if you ask me to configure my attention in space, which we can do pretty well, that is, something's going to happen out here, but not here. So I have to look here, but I have to attend out here. Okay, that's a hard thing to do, but we actually do it all the time. Then high spans can do that very well. Low spans have a real difficult time doing that. Mind wandering, the ability to keep your focus on what you're supposed to be doing. My former student and postdoc, Mike Kane, has had a paper in Psych Science recently done. It's got a whole body of papers getting ready to come out showing that low spans are much, if you give subjects a PDA, and at various times during the day, the PDA pings them and says, okay, did you have your mind on what you were supposed to be doing? Were you actually listening to Engel speak? Or were you thinking about it? It's almost lunchtime. Well, most fans are much more likely to be mind blown. Okay, now that's actually important, isn't it? You know, knowing how, why, when people mind wander is hugely important. The answer to the task I'm going to tell you about very quickly, and it is an elegant task that allows us to look at attention control, and Los Angeles works on that. So, now I thought about this as a trait variable, as I said to you, and there's good evidence for that. So we have a pretty good understanding of the brain structures involved. You know that high and low span subjects differ in the activity of the prefrontal cortex. The anterior cingulate is a real good meter for detecting error. There's probably something happening there. And in the relationship between the anterior cingulate and prefrontal cortex, possibly also basal ganglia. We also have a pretty good idea about the neurotransmitters involved. We know that this certainly the dopamine system is involved, which of the five different dopamines we don't quite know yet, but we're honing in on that. There's something called bromocriptine, which is a dopamine agonist. We can actually give this drug to high spans and low spans. It turns out what you do is you help low spans do a lot better, but you actually hurt high spans. So there's this inverted U-shaped Yerkes-Dodson kind of function that goes with that that's important. Serotonin, possibly. Serotonin is a very attention-related neurotransmitter, and whether these two things are totally separable or related, I don't know, but I hope to have the answer for that in 3 years. That's how long my brain goes. Genes, there's really a long list of possibilities here. Catecholamine methyltransferase is a polymorphic gene that regulates the uptake, reuptake of dopamine. That seems to track working memory capacity pretty well. Dopamine transporter is important. You can't see that at the bottom. It says tryptophan hydroxylase 2. That's a serotonin. I don't think that. Oh, there you go. What a simple solution. I was thinking, well, we could move that, or we could just move the screen. Anyway, these are all, you know, there are great unknowns here. Okay. So we can think of working memory as a trait variable, but over the last 5 to 8 years, it's become clear to me that we can think about it as a state variable as well. One of those things that affects working memory is whatever gives rise to these traits. But also, we look at things like sleep deprivation, for example. Very quickly, about a study that I was involved in with Air Force or military pilots. Anybody know what this is? Any Americans in the audience?
Drone.
No, it's not a drone at all.
I wish it were.
It's a B-2. That's a $2 billion machine there. And six people sit in the cockpit of this thing, and they fly. When we draw a load of big, big bombs in Iraq, the plane takes off from a city in Missouri. That's the way they say Missouri. And they fly all the way to Iraq. They fly all the way back. They're refueled in air. But these pilots and navigators and all those people, they don't sleep for 30 hours. Okay. So the military is very interested in this idea of sleep and sleep deprivation effects on cognitive performance. The rest of us should be as well. I just flew here. I'm going to Poland next month and Japan the month after. There's a great deal of evidence that transatlantic pilots, even though they're only supposed to be awake 18 hours, you know, that assumes that when they were home, they were asleep. And that turns out to be, you know, a risky assumption in most cases. And particularly in the medical world, this is another one. Let me back up here. This is one where, you know, big truckers, I had uncles who were truckers, and they talked about the drugs they take to stay awake and all of this. These guys violate these rules all of the time. You know, and if you're on a two-lane highway, you're driving down the road at 60 miles an hour. I don't know how that translates to kilometers. And you got one of these guys coming at you at 60. That's 120 miles that you're approaching a wall. All right. And if that person's been awake for a long time, that's an issue. You'd like to know what that person's cognition is like. This is more common. Turns out, and I just finished a big study with medical residents in Minnesota, and an awful lot of, as an aside here, why this is such an interesting problem, an awful lot of the new medical students are females. And they're females of childbearing age. And women of childbearing age often do. And so these are medical residents doing a full shift, sometimes two, sometimes three shifts. There's a limit to how many they're supposed to do according to the hospital threatening societies. Then these people go home. The assumption is they're asleep. Anybody here have young children? When'd you last sleep? So it's, and I'm guessing your wife, egalitarian as it is awake a little more. Yeah, particularly if she's breastfeeding. So it's an issue. I mean, what we find is that many of our residents come in the morning, and they nominally have been awake. Well, it's an issue. We did this study with Air Force and other military pilots, and this big, hugely expensive 4X simulator, and what all that does, and think quickly about the study. It's only got 10 people, 10 military pilots of this age range. But look at the expertise, if you will. This is the number of flight hours. Averages from 207 up to 5,800 hours. That's 5,800 hours of actual flying time. That's a lot. So we're dealing with somebody who's quite expert. And many of the people who study expertise, like Anders Ericsson, for example, would argue that these fluid ability kind of things don't have any importance to as people become more and more expert. That's absurd. I've told him that. You can tell him I said that as well. And this shows that. So these people we keep them for a long time. They arrive and they stay awake for 10 sessions. We test them every 2 hours on a whole battery of tests. A very common measure of effects of sleep deprivation, something called social vigilance task. Very simple task, you're looking at a display of zeros. At some point, it becomes a millisecond clock. The zeros just start progressing. And you have to press a button just to keep it as low as possible. People have done it with transatlantic pilots and so forth. And it's reasonably effective. They also did the operation span in this study. The vigilance task predicts performance after 18 hours of deprivation in just these 10 at 0.44, reasonably high level. The operation span predicted at 0.65. So we're dealing with something here that's quite important and able, sensitive to pick up errors, even in these highly expert people, as a function of sleep deprivation. So when I talk about working memory capacity as a state variable, I'm talking about how my working memory capacity varies over the course of the day, over the course of other things that are happening to me, and so forth. So just quickly, some of the other things that we drugs, alcohol. Peter Finn has done a great deal at Indiana University, has done a great deal of work with alcoholics, showing two things about alcohol. One is that if you look at people who are alcoholics but in a treatment program, you measure the working memory capacity at the moment, and you bring them into a room and you set them down in front of a glass of orange juice that's got vodka in it. How long do they wait before they tackle that orange juice? Turns out working memory capacity predicts that very well, the ability to control their behavior. In addition, alcohol diminishes working memory capacity substantially. You all know that. I certainly know that. Senile, we mentioned Alzheimer's type. Student of mine, Jenny Rosen, worked with a set of individuals. I have to explain this population a little bit. This is studied at the National Institutes of Health. She's got two publications on this. With a sample, all of the subjects in the sample are children of people who have and show symptoms of early onset dementia. That is, these are people who became demented in the 50s. That's early for Alzheimer's. All of the parents of these subjects have the ApoE allele. It's an allele that's heavily associated. If you have that, let me just say, if you have that, immediately walk out of this room and, well, you guys don't need it because you have a healthcare system. In America, I say immediately find an insurance company that doesn't take your genes into account and buy a long-term care policy. Okay? Because the chances are about 85 to 90% you're going to be demented by the time you're 60. But these people had chosen not to know. These are the children of these subjects. Half of these subjects have the allele, half don't. They chose not to know. The experimenter doesn't know. It's a true double-blind experiment, very rare in psychology. And so the question is, none of these people show any overt symptoms of Alzheimer's. What distinguishes them? Well, lots of studies have shown they couldn't find anything. Turns out the operation span distinguishes between those who have the allele and those who don't. So this task, these tasks, these complex fan tasks, are measuring something that's like a canary in the mine, if you will. Early effects on attention control. I think that's very, very important. Life event stress, I won't go into that. Stereotype threat, Tony Schrader is a social psychologist, Jennifer Richardson is a social psychologist. Both of them have done really interesting work on the effects of stereotype threat. Does everybody know what stereotype threat is? That if you bring people into a room and give them a test, if you just say, answer these questions, you might find, at Stanford, for example, Claude Steele found no differences between his black and white students on this test, unless he said, this test is an intelligence test. And all of a sudden, boom, there were these culturally derived, you know, the stereotype induced this threat and these differences emerged. You find the same thing with women in math. If you say, just do this test, you might find relatively little difference between men and women on a math test. But if you say, this is a math test, and in the past, you know, we found big differences between men and women, turns out to find the same thing with Latinos and non-Latinos. I mean, these culturally derived stereotypes induce a threat. And so there's been all kinds of explanations given to this about anxiety and so forth. And Tony and Jennifer have made the argument that, in fact, what you're doing is you're actually reducing working memory capacity. And to make a long story short, there's great deal of evidence for that. Let me quickly shift to arguments that this is really attention control that we're talking about. This is a task that I'd really like to use. It's an elegant little task called the Anderson Quad Task. And in this task, the subject's sitting in front of a computer screen, and they're fixated, there's a little circle there. At some point, the circle turns into the word ready. The subject doesn't see these crosshairs here. We're measuring eye movements, and that's to tell you, the audience, where the eyes are fixating. And at some point, if they fixate on the ready signal within a degree of the ready signal long enough, the trial starts. So let me show you. I'm going to show you two trials. This is at half speed, so it's actually happening in real world a lot faster than this. And so we have two conditions here, one of which is the prosaccade condition. And in the prosaccade condition, if this box blinks, you're to look immediately to that box. That's all you have to do. No button presses, no words to pronounce. Just look at the box that blinks. We certainly predict that there would be no differences between high and low working memory individuals in the prosaccade condition. 15 million years of evolution have prepared you to look at things that blink. Because things that blink can eat you, or you can eat them. Both are important at the brainstem level. Alligators show prosaccade behavior easily, right? Rattlesnakes, you name it. Low spams do very well on prosaccade. The really interesting condition is the anisocade, because if this one blinks, you're immediately to look that way. Even a slight deflection over here is taken as an error. Is that clear? Now, everybody knows that. The question is, what happens when the trial hits? I'm going to show you two trials. Can everybody see the crosshairs okay? Error. Now notice what happened. The eye movements immediately go to the ceiling, looking for divine guidance or something. This one's correct. Boom. Now that's at half speed. So we're dealing with something here very, 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 very fast. And if we look at the prosaccade condition, we see no difference between highs and lows. High and lows are in blue. But when we go to the anisocade condition, both are hurt. Look at the difference now between highs and lows. In this exceedingly simple, it's hard to call this a cognitive task. The argument here is that everybody knows when you walk up to the street corner, look to your right, look to your right, look to your right. But if you're under load and you're thinking about other things, boom, you walk up to the street corner, you look to your left, and you take a step. Okay, or you follow the wind. That is, you go to this most highly activated representation. Attention network. Mike Posner's argued for at least three varieties of attention here. General readiness. Everybody get ready. Are you ready? Something's going to happen. Can't tell you where. Auditory visual. Don't know. Get ready. Alert. Oriented. Something's going to happen over here. That's a different function, a different type of attention. And in fact, Posner has argued that there are different neurotransmitters involved, different parts of the brain, probably right about that. And this executive control, which is the ability to resolve conflict. Don't look at the blinking thing, look over here. It's associated with Stroop and Flanker. This is a Flanker task. You have to just say the one that's right above the fixation point is pointed to the right or to the left. This is incompatible, this is compatible. Get a difference between those blank lights, different scores, which is psychometrically horrible. But, so we predict that working memory should be important in the executive, but I didn't really make a prediction about alerting or orienting. Turns out it's fine that high and low span subjects didn't really, high and low, by the way, upper and lower quartiles on these other metrics. I didn't tell you that, sorry. And the alerting and the orienting, they're really not that different. On the executive, they're really hugely. So the take-home message is that this thing we call working memory capacity really reflects individual differences, I think, in the ability to control the contents of the focus of attention. And also to get back recently activated information back to the control of focus of attention. It plays a really important role in just a lot of different things in regulation of cognition, emotion, and behavior broadly defined. So to call it cognitive control, I think, is a bit simple. I think that this construct really reflects some aspect of the functioning of some brain areas that we are understanding pretty well, particularly the frontal executive areas, EFC, Brodmann areas 9 and 46, possibly even 10. 10 is a really interesting thing that's coming into its own in brain science and the anterior cingulate. Role of genetics in the system, but what we there's a great deal we don't know about that. My point, anybody here study genetics at all? There's a lot of noise in behavioral genetics right now, in my opinion, because they don't understand psychometrics. So they'll pick one task and use that to study. The impact is working memory. Well, it's a horrible way to do this. And so that's what you get. If you get people doing 500 subjects showing comp is really important, and somebody else doing 500 subjects saying comp is not important, and it's because of the tasks they're using. So it's also important as a state variable, and I think that's really important for us to understand. And this says, you know, why the nature of the construct is really important in maintaining task relevant, rapid access to task relevant information, suppressing inhibition. I've not talked about that, but I think it's really important. Alan Bialystok at York's doing some really interesting work on bilinguals that I think is hugely interesting. You know, I've talked about this a good bit. And the flexibility of attention allocation, just our ability to shift attention around in the environment and control the contents of my attention or the focus of my attention and keep irrelevant things from intruding into that. All these papers are available there. The tasks are available there. Stop there. Thank you very much.